Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's Michigan Engineering DEI lecture. I'm Sarah Pozzi. I'm a professor in nuclear engineering and radiological sciences here at the College of Engineering, and I'm also the Director of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion at Michigan Engineering. I'd like to welcome you all, both folks from within the University of Michigan, and I know we have some folks from outside the university, so welcome. It's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker. Today's speaker is Paulette Vincent-Ruz. She is a postdoctoral fellow in discipline-based education research at the University of Michigan. She graduated with a Bachelor of Science in Chemical Engineering from the National Autonomous University of Mexico in Mexico and earned her PhD in Learning Sciences and Policy from the University of Pittsburgh, the School of Education. Her research seeks to build an understanding of the systemic disadvantages that hinder the success of marginalized students and their effect on student STEM attitudes, opportunities, and learning by using equity-centered theories and methodologies. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Vincent-Ruz and hand it over to her for her presentation. We will then have a question and answer. So as you think of your questions, please share them with us so that we can ask them at the end. Dr. Vincent-Ruz, floor is yours.
Thank you so much. I'm very excited to be here and thank you so much for the invitation. Thank you for everybody that is attending today. I wanna recognize that there's a lot going on in the world right now, and that for you, so for some of you, everything that's happening in this country and outside of it, it's something that is making it very hard to engage or even like just be present. So I thank you for taking the time to be here with me today. I'm gonna share my screen so we can start. Right here. Okay, so I want to start by acknowledging and paying respect to the original and rightful owners of the land in which we're meeting today. These are the Odawa, Ojibwe, and Potawatomi and Wainaut nations, and it is upon their ancestral lands that the University of Michigan is built today. And it's something that is very important to recognize, that we're in an institution that is built on stolen lands. So I want to start with by telling you a story. When I was in grad school, I was part of this project and we needed to give this presentation to a bunch of experts on the field. It was about 15 of them, and show the results that we were having on this grant. And the purpose of it was just so they will like tell us if we were going in the right direction or if we were missing anything, right? So amongst the presentations that were supposed to happen, my advisor said, you know, you work really hard this first year of grad school. You have a paper almost finished to go into submission. Why don't you present your results? And this is a great opportunity for you to get feedback, right, from them. And I was like, oh, this is so exciting. He trusts me to present my research. This is going to be great. So I, you know, stood up, gave my presentation, right, as a first year grad student. And at the end, I just waited, right, for the Q&A, right, the dreaded Q&A portion of this situation. So the first person raised their hand, and I was ready, right? I was just like, I'm ready. But instead of that, this person turned around, looked at my advisor, and asked the question directly to him. And my advisor's response was, you know, Paulette has worked in this project. She's the one who did it. She can answer your question. And so it was not until my advisor basically gave permission or validated my knowledge, right, in front of all these experts, that he asked me the question to me. And I wish I could tell you this only happened once, but every single person that asked a question during the session would first ask the question to my advisor and wait for confirmation almost that I was capable enough to answer before the question will be redirected to me. And even though I had to keep, you know, my smile on my face and still try to be like calm and present, in my head, right, there is many things happening, but most of it, I was thinking that I had been caught, right? I had an accent and it was probable that my accent was too thick and people were not able to understand me. at least that is what I used to think many years ago, that maybe I was not good enough to be in a research program and that my English as a second language was always going to be a barrier for me to be successful. So I was like, inside I was dying, right? Later that day, we took everybody for dinner, because that is what you do in this kinds of situations. And as a grad student, you always say yes to a free dinner. And one of the people that we invited sat down next to me, right? And she turned around and she asked me like, so I can tell you have an accent. Where are you from? And if you have an accent, you know what this question actually means, right? But back then I thought, you know, maybe this person actually wants to know how I got here, right? What my journey has been, why I'm studying this type of questions. And I was so ready, right? I was so ready to tell her about how I had gone to the best university in Latin America, how I had done research in chemistry from very early on, because I was just so in love with it. And that I worked super hard as an undergrad, so hard that I had been part of a publication as an undergrad, and also I had done an honors thesis, right? But she was not interested in any of this information. Really, the reason she was asking where I was from is because she was surprised that I wanted to do statistical methods on my research, because she would go on to say, how come you like statistics when Latinas are bad at math? She said it so matter of factly, like if this was a universal truth, and I was such an uncommon being for just being able to add and subtract things, statistically speaking, right? What happened in this situation has many layers, right? But one of the layers that I want to emphasize right now is this idea of how achievement gaps language is actually what creates this perception of things like this, things like Latinas are bad at math becoming a reality on people's heads. So what I mean by achievement gaps, it means that whenever we have a score of something, so in this case, I'm showing you a graph of SAT math, national averages, right? And you can see that Latinx women, right, score around the 30th percentile, and white women score around the 50th percentile. And so usually an achievement gap will mean, oh, we know what certain people in certain groups don't do as good as their white counterparts, right? And we have done policies and we have done changes in the classroom, and no matter what we do, this gap still persists, right? And so this is what achievement gaps mean. But this language actually perpetuates something that is called the racism, race reification process. That means that we start believing, right, race, which is a social construct that is not real, right? We start believing it has a biological connection and that actually has the predictive properties genetically to predict our ability, right? So that is what racism, race reification means. And using achievement gaps language causes that and causes us to believe that Latinas are bad at math, right? Like if this was a genetic predisposition that we have. And so these type of experiences is really what drove me to do a research program that focuses specifically at the college level, science education questions. And I specifically do this in the field of chemistry education research. So for those who are not familiar with what this would mean, I just want you to think about chemistry. You know, chemistry is a discipline. You know, you need to understand the current trends in the field. And the same way that biochemists need biology and chemistry to understand the problems they're asking, right? When we do chemistry education, we need chemistry and learning sciences in order to understand questions about how people learn chemistry, what should they know, and how can we know they know. And I know that sounded like a mouthful. And historically, because this is an area of research that has come from disciplines, from departments of science. So you would have engineering education, you would have physics education, biology education, right? These sort of disciplines came from chemistry departments, biology departments, physics departments. There's this tendency to use the statistical methods to ask this sort of questions. This is tradition, not necessarily everybody. And the thing that I do differently from the field specifically is I also bring equity and justice scholarship in the way in which we look at things. And this will become very important as I move on to my talk about why it's very important that when you're using statistics to bring in an equity and justice scholarship lens to the question. But first, I'm going to talk to you about how I theoretically see things. So I proposed a framework called the Resources for Equitable Activation of Chemical Thinking Framework. This was a book chapter that I was invited to write as a postdoc. And the gist is that I wanted to create a framework that would allow us to take into account the different influences in the classroom. So we're used to thinking about the classroom as just what happens between the instructors and the students. But the reality is that everything that happens in the classroom is also influenced by the university context of the particular place we're studying, and also by the accepted ways of knowing of the discipline we're working with, okay? And so through this work, I've been asking and answering questions related to how to not only focus on cognitive processes. So we're used to thinking about only how do we develop knowledge? How do we develop skills in science? But I also want to ask questions about what are the feelings students bring in into the classroom? And I know this sounds not very scientific, right? Well, you're taking into account feelings. What do we think? Why does this matter? But a lot of my research has actually shown that your feelings and the attitudes you bring in actually affect the way you learn, right? So it's not that these three things are separate from each other, but they're actually interacting with each other all the time. And there's a big gap in the literature because we rarely look at affective resources as part of the causes of the things we see in the classroom. The second thing I do is that in the field, in DVR, discipline-based education research and chemistry education, we love doing interventions, like we love doing changes in the classroom, but we rarely understand why they are working. So if they work or not work, it's a thing, it's one thing, right? But the actual mechanism of what they're causing students and why they're helping students become better, that is usually something that is not very well understood. And so when we find something that works and we try to apply it in a different context, or we want to scale it to a bigger population, right, and it breaks, we really don't know how to fix it because we don't have an understanding of the mechanism behind it. And finally, the third thing I do in my research is to really think about how to connect systemic oppression to learning processes. So systemic oppressions are things like racism, sexism, ableism, right? But actually looking at how they present themselves in the classroom is not as simple. Racism is not a thing that can be measured, right? We cannot measure racism or sexism. What we often can only see is the consequences of these actions, or we can measure certain like actions that people may be doing in the classroom, but we need to be very careful about how we conceptualize these things. So we need to bring something that is very, very broad and very, very abstract, right? And think about what is really, what do we think is happening in the classroom so we can actually study it. And this is something very difficult to do. And this is something that I'm doing in my research. So my framework addresses these three areas that I just talked to you. And that is the point of it. That is why I created it. But this was very theoretical, right? And so you may ask yourself, well, what does it mean for me as a practitioner, right? Like beyond the philosophy and beyond this theory, right? Why should I care about what you're saying? So I'm going to tell you, I'm going to show you an example of why this matters. So this is Anthony. Anthony Rojas is an instructor at a private liberal arts college. He is in charge of teaching General Chemistry 1. He usually teaches three sections, about 100 students. And he was very interested in applying evidence-based practices in the classroom because he's a compassionate instructor that like wanted to improve the access of chemistry to everybody in his classroom. So he was aware that there's inequities in the system, that not everybody is often allowed to succeed. And he wanted to make things in his classroom to fix this problem, right? And so he chose to use a flipped classroom methodology. So for those who are not familiar with this, this means that students will usually look at the lecture outside of school time in a video. They may do some readings, and the classroom time would be used actually for activities and discussion, rather than the traditional way of just lecturing and doing homework on the outside. for all intents and purposes, what Anthony was doing looked great. His results looked pretty normal. And by mean normal, they looked normal to the department. The department was happy, right? Like they were looking, enough people were passing the class, enough people were getting A's, but not too many people, because if too many people get A's, you know, that is not a good thing. The right amount of number of students were failing from the department's perspective. So everything looked fine, right? But Anthony, again, was conscious that there might be inequities in his classroom. And so that this result that is overall, right, might be hiding things. So he looked at the student analytics of his class. And this is done usually by using the learning management system that many people have now access to in their classrooms. And particularly in his university, he was able to link his data to students' information, like demographic information. And what he found was that there was like a general difference or gap in chemistry one performance, right? So he observed that white students were scoring around a V range of a grade, while non-white students were scoring around a C range. And he said, this is a problem, right? I'm doing something wrong in my class. I need to do something better. What can I do? And so he went to the source of the problem, and by the source of, like, to ask the source of the problem, like, and by that I mean he went to the journals of the field that are meant to give the answers to practitioners about this, right? He's not a chemistry education researcher. So he said, okay, I'm going to go to the experts, and the experts hopefully will tell me what is the solution to this problem that I'm seeing in my classroom. So these are the two main journals in the chemistry education field. If you're in engineering, right, there's journals of engineering education, right? And a practitioner will normally be, we would hope them to go look at these journals for solutions. The problem is that at least my field, right, chemistry education, pointed that perseverance was the root of the problem. So the root of the problem is not so much that Anthony was doing something wrong in the classroom, according to these papers, right? Is more than, you know, there's a pipeline and some people leave and some people stay. And the people that leave just happen to not be as perseverant as the others, which is a very problematic way of looking at things. But he, you know, as somebody that is evidence-driven, said, okay, if this is true, then I should be able to observe this in my classroom. So he actually gave students a survey about perseverance and interest, right? And said, okay, if this is true, right? If this explanation is true, I should be able to project the final grade of students, right? And perseverance should be the projector, right? Like you would do in a normal regression. But what actually happened is that perseverance and interest were not statistically significant, right? And by this, I mean that they were not predicting the final grade, as students' perseverance and interest was not explaining the result he was observing in his class. And so he was left with a model that was still pointing out to race as a root of the problem, right? Oh, just happens that students that are non-white just do worse, right? And this is not only a non-practical model, because we cannot change people's race, but also again, is a reification problem, right? Because it's a model that still is telling us that this is something that has to do with race and not with anything else, which is wrong. So after he saw some talk about me and my friend work, or and some things I've said on Twitter actually about how perseverance is usually not the lens we wanna look at in order to support students that are marginalized, he reached out to me and we sat down to talk about what he had done in his classroom, what his concerns were, right? And we created a collaboration in order to actually try to find the root of the problem that he was observing. So first we had a theoretical problem, right? Like, as I said, the problem is that we were first looking at this through a lens of persistence. And so this means that we were thinking that persistence through obstacles has to be the goal of our instruction in science. And that means that marginalized students, even though we know they have to go through way more obstacles than other people, the solution is not to destroy the barriers, it's actually to make them hyper persistent, which is, again, wrong. Because our goal should be to destroy the barriers the students are going through, rather than using language that is trying to put the onus on the students to survive a system that was just not created for them in the first place. And this language of hyper-persistence of achievement gaps, right? He's been appearing in like journals across all the discipline-based education fields. And so this is not only a chemistry problem. This is like a general way in which we're looking the way students fail or succeed in the college classroom. So we decided to change the way we're looking at things. So instead of looking at things through the lens of persistence, we decided to look at the way students were engaging in his class and see if there was a particular problem in any of this particular situations. So this is what I mean by this. So students were able to engage with the content in three ways, right? They had exams that are high stakes content that are usually really stressful, right? Students also could engage in the class component, which was mostly discussion and doing problems, right? And students could engage with the content in the flip class component, which is like looking at the videos, doing the reading, etc. And so by actually putting this explicitly, we're saying, okay, we are observing a problem in which marginalized students are not being supported, right? Is it that they're not being supported in the three different ways of engaging the way content, or is it one particular way in which we're failing these students? And so this allows us to actually try to like tease apart the different things that are happening in the classroom and look at where the problem was actually happening, right? So this is the first thing that I want you to think about when you're thinking about problems in your classroom. Think about the different ways in which students are engaging with your content, and then try to look at each of them separately and see if one of those things is actually missing supports that marginalized students need to be successful. The second thing that I wanted to change in the way we're looking at things is to stop seeing quantitative methods as inherently objective, so that we could, like, I didn't want to look at this issue and say, okay, we can just go collect data, do a regression, and get like a solution automatically, assuming that quantitative methods can get us to the truth. And the reason for this is that the history of quantitative methods in social sciences is actually very problematic. A lot of the statistical methods that we use nowadays in social sciences and in education actually were built to prove racial differences in intelligence. So particularly Carl Pearson, who's a very famous statistician, designed statistical methods to prove there were differences in intelligence between white and non-white groups. And one of the best examples of how he applied this to education is in this study he did, he went and studied Jewish and Russian Jewish children, right? And he wanted to prove that they were less smart than white British kids. And so he went to a school of white students and gave them an intelligence test that he developed for adults and gave it to the white kids. And they actually did pretty well, right? They were scoring close to 100, which was what he deemed a normal score. And then he took this test that was developed for adults in English and gave it to immigrant kids that were not native English speakers, right? And they, of course, didn't do well, but they didn't do well not because they were not smart. It's because they were immigrant kids whose language was not English, right? And so, of course, they were going to fail this test that was very heavily language-based. And this idea, he actually, instead of thinking about this, he actually said that he found a clear link between race and intelligence, right? And so he would even say in his conclusions that taking an average and regarding both sexes, this L in Jewish population is somewhat inferior physically and mentally to the native population. This is obviously very explicitly racist and very explicitly eugenicist, right? But what I want to show to you is that this sort of logic of finding an achievement gap, simplify a model, and use race as the proxy for the cause of the effects that we see in education is actually something that we're still carrying out in the way we do education research today. Because if you look at most of the papers that get published, we are applying statistical methods like this in the name of objectivity without understanding that the past is actually telling, like, was applying them with very specific racist objectives. So we still look for achievement gaps, right? Who's doing better and who's not doing as well. We still simplify models. We still go and just measure this simplified model, calculate some statistics, and publish a paper and repeat the cycle over and over and over again. And we just keep repeating this cycle of like showing there's an achievement gap here, there's an achievement gap here, there's an achievement gap here, right? but we never actually take the time to actually understand what is the problem, where the problem is coming from. And we just keep creating these links of race or gender or neurodivergence, right? Showing that those students are not succeeding in our classrooms without never stopping to think about how we build structures that are just meant to make the students fail on purpose. So what the way to solve this, right, is to actually apply critical race theory principles to statistics. So this means going back to how people that do critical theories, not only critical race theory, but critical gender studies, critical trans studies, et cetera, right? And look at how they're explaining problems, how they're like basing their research, right? And try to apply this as principles of how we do statistics in the way we apply to education today. And this is what it means to do quant crit. So quant crit means applying critical theories to quantitative methods rather than applying positivist theories to quantitative methods. And so something that I've done in my work is to actually just take this very philosophical thing that I'm telling you of grabbing this very philosophical theories, right? And turn them into actionable principles that we can apply to discipline-based education research. So I did this by creating actionable principles and then making sure these principles are connected to questions that researchers can ask themselves while they're doing a research study. So the first principle is to contextualize systems of oppression. And basically what I want is to researchers or practitioners to ask themselves, okay, what is wrong with the current social reality, right? Let's just start by assuming the system is wrong rather than that the system is correct, right? And so then let's explicitly say what is the problem with the system that we're facing. Second principle is to reorient from student to system level. And this means, yes, we can look at how students are behaving. We can look at individual level things from students, but it's very important that we also think about who are the people empowered to make changes, because usually students are not the people empowered to make changes, right? And so we're thinking about solutions in the classroom. Let's think about solutions that actually target the actors that have the power to make changes. The third one is to ground things in social historical context. So this means to ask yourself, what are the beliefs I'm bringing to the project? Who I am to be asking these questions? What are the biases I'm bringing in to be asking these questions? And it also means to ask yourself, what is the social historical context of this classroom or this university, right? When did we start accepting students that were marginalized? What have we done to support students that are marginalized, et cetera? The fourth one is to elevate and honor marginalized voices. So how is this analysis amplifying the experiences, narratives, and truths of marginalized communities, rather than telling the status quo narrative all over again? And the fifth one is to acknowledge that there's a limit to quantitative methods. Not everything can be answered with numbers. And it's wrong to try to force every single question into a numbers-based solution. Right, so this will be context depending on the project you're doing or the question you're answering, but it's very important that we're conscious to know when this limit has been achieved, right? And so the idea is to think about how each of these principles actually apply to each of the steps in a research process or a practitioner process. And I'm gonna show you what I mean by that. So now, I'm going to show you the same exact problem, the same exact thing that Anthony was dealing with. But instead of using traditional way of applying quantitative methods, I'm going to apply quant crit principles to try to look at the solution to Anthony's problem in the classroom. Okay? So step one, right, is to really think about how we're creating categories and what do they mean, right? So we started by using this category, which was underrepresented minority or non-white students, right? But this is very hard to really draw practical implications from, because each student, depending on their culture, their race, or their ethnicity, will have different barriers that they have to go through in order to like succeed in science. And so it's very important that we actually look at this disaggregated, because we cannot claim that Black and Latinx students' experiences are the same, for example. Statistically speaking, we cannot have categories that are like lower than five usually. So we cannot have a category that is n equals one. And so usually what we would do is to just combine them and we would be left with three categories, right? Like just disaggregating one more level to Black, Latinx, and other marginalized students. And this is again not theoretically meaningful because we have a mix of Asian and Indigenous students and mixed race students in here. And so I am making the decision to just not show you the results for this category because there will be more harm done by showing you the graphs with them in place. And our brains are built to try to like automatically try to like make sense of the things we're looking at. And I know there's a consequence of this in that I'm erasing them from the narrative, right? But in this case, as I don't have additional information, qualitative data to actually bring their voices into a project in a way that actually honors their experiences, I'm choosing the thing that I think is the less hurtful situation. But it's not perfect in any way. The other thing that I want to say is that ethnicity obviously is not a race and that within Latinx, there's a lot of like nuance, but I don't have any more data to disaggregate another level because this is institutional data. And institutional data usually doesn't go that nuanced, right? So this is a limit of the data I'm using for this study. And I just wanted to acknowledge it. The second thing I wanted to do is to think, okay, what is the purpose of looking at comparing students' performance across scores? Right, so we started this story by saying students in group A were scoring like close to a B and students in group B were in the other group were scoring close to a C, right? And why is this an important question to answer, right? Okay, so grades actually matter. Matter because they build acceptance into medical school. They are used to decide whether you're gonna follow up through the sequence. Their grad school filtering criteria, right? So even though I wish I could tell you that grades don't matter, grades in the system do. They're currency, right? And they have an impact in the dreams and aspirations and social mobility of students. So that is why looking at grades might be meaningful. But what is actually the way it's better to look at this? So instead of looking at this in averages, right? Like who is on average doing better? Let's look at whether we're systemically failing a specific group of students because that is where the equity issue happens, right? We're systematically failing a group more than another. We have a huge equity issue that it's affecting students' dreams, aspirations, and social mobility. And so this is exactly what we observe here. So if we look at Black, Latinx, and white students, and we look at the letter range where they scored, we see two things. Thing number one is, Black and Latinx students are less likely to score in the A and B range, right? So that's problem number one, because A and B range is usually the scores that help you get into grad school, go into med school, et cetera, right? But problem two is Black students are just way more likely to fail this class. And again, either you believe Black students cannot do science, or you need to acknowledge something is wrong is happening in this classroom. Right? Those are the possible explanations, right? And so given that we don't believe students are not good, like we don't think it's because students are not good at science, it's because we're doing something wrong, right? Then let's ask ourselves, okay, where is the problem happening, right? So let's start with the exams. Is there a problem with the exams, right? Are students failing systematically the exams or not? So let's look. This class had four exams. Three partial exams and a final exam, pretty traditional in any STEM classroom, right? And so when we look at the mean differences by each exam, right? Like, is there differences in exam one? Is there differences in exam two? Is there differences in exam three? They're not clean mean differences across them, right? Statistically speaking, it's not statistically significant. Is that how I would say? But as I've shown you, grades can, like, means hide things, right? If we look at means, we would not have noticed there was a systematic failure of certain group of students, right? So if we look only at means here, we can also miss certain information. So let's look at exam one and exam two as an example of this. This type of graph is called a bi-lean plot. So on the x-axis, we have each category of group of students. On the y-axis, we have the grade they got on the exam. A violin plot gives you a sense of the range. So the minimum and maximum grade each group had, right? So it gives you range. And it also gives you a sense of distribution. So places that are thicker have more students. Places that are thinner have less students, right? That is what like a violin plot is helping us see. Okay, so look at exam one. And I drew a line on the 60 score, right? And as you can see in exam one, very few people fail that exam, right? So like the distributions tend to be very narrow, right? In that sense. Okay, now look at exam two. Suddenly in exam two, way more students are likely to fail that exam. Not only that, if you look at the thickness of the distributions and the range, we can see that Black and Latinx students, there are more Black and Latinx students failing, right, than white students. And this goes back to the question of what are we assessing? So on exam one, we're actually asking questions about atom substance and composition, which are usually conceptual questions. And in exam two, we're mostly asking questions about stoichiometry and thermochemistry, which are algorithmic questions. So math, basically exam two has math, right? And there is a lot of information on the literature about how students are not trained adequately in high school to think about math problems and science. So it's not just applying algebra to science. There's actually a lot that has to go in into the way we reason through problems in order to apply mathematical principles to chemistry or biology or physics. And if your high school or the place you went before college didn't train you to do that, you're gonna struggle a lot here, right? But that is a systemic problem. That's a problem of the system. So I want you to think about who's more likely to have gone to a school where this didn't happen, right? And so what happens here is that what we have is an accumulation of small differences, right? The differences are not statistically significant independently, but if you add the small failure, the small difference of failing in exam two and then in exam three, and then in the final exam, because the final exam also has a lot of math, you end up with a statistically significant difference at the end, right? It's an accumulation of small differences that ends up being a problem at the end of the class. And this is a systemic debt in how math is taught, but also in the way we don't address how math is taught on the classroom. We usually just re-explain how to apply the algebraic principle, and then sorry if you got it, sorry if you didn't get it, right? We actually don't have a way of addressing this in the classroom specifically. So we don't solve the problem, we just let the problem continue. Okay, that is problem number one. And the other problem was, again, about the differences between in-person behavior and flipped class component behavior. And so how do we think about this? Let's think about this very simple. When you go to a class, right, when you show up to the in-class component, you show at least a willingness to engage in person, right? And then you have the content that is online, watching the videos, doing the reading, so you can click through it, right? So it's at least a willingness to engage in the flipped content. Right? This is the best we can do with this data. So I want you to think about this. And the question is, do I observe differences in behavior between these two things? And so Latinx and white students behave very similarly. They were equally likely to engage or show up to the classroom, to the discussion section. And they were also equally likely, to then engage on the flip component. However, Black students were more likely to engage on the flip component and not to engage in the classroom component, right? And so here we have a clear difference that can also help us understand what's happening. However, here's one of the places where quantitative methods, I just got stumped here, right? I didn't have any more data to look at. This was data that was collected before I joined the project. This is as far as I could get with it, right? And so I had to think about, again, from my framework, okay, my framework says that there's influences beyond the classroom that may be causing these behaviors, right? So what I started to do was look at what was happening in that institution around this time and to see if that explained why Black students were less likely to show up into the classroom. because again, we go back to this question, right? Either we think that Black students inherently don't care or are more lazy, or there's a reason why they're choosing to not show up, right? Okay. So exactly during the time this data was collected, so during that term, there was at least 4 instances of racial graffiti happening in the campus where this data was collected. And so this caused Black students specifically to do sit-ins, protests, to actually call attention to university and to put their safety on as a priority, right? So basically, outside of this chemistry classroom, bigger things were happening, right? Things that will mean students may choose to just engage online because that was safer for them, or because they could engage online, they could use the in-person time to go and protest for their rights to exist on this campus. A climate survey that was given this semester after this one showed that 34% of Black students reported exclusionary, intimidating, offensive, and/or hostile conduct on campus, and that Black students are less likely to see themselves as academically successful versus white students in this campus again. So we're seeing that there's a pattern of inequity as a university context, not only in the classroom, right? That can explain why we saw these differences in behavior. And so this means that when we ground our model in a social historical context, right? We have a primarily white institution that started accepting Black students to try to diversify their student population, right? But didn't do the work to make sure those students were safe, right? And the consequence of that is that students are choosing to maybe not engage with the content in the classroom and instead are trying to fight for their right to just be heard and safe in the campus where they're like existing currently. And so this is what it means to apply critical principles to quantitative methods, right? Through this whole story, I've been showing you how we need to disaggregate, but also think about how the explanations have to come from the system rather from the students, right? And so we've been filling this table as we go, right? And so I'm not gonna just show it complete because that way you will be excited to read the publication when it comes out. And so finally, the conclusion of this project is that equitable outcomes require equity-centered research, right? If you wanna do equitable research, if you wanna find equity solutions, you need to start always with an equity-centered framing and with equity-centered methods. So first, what we learned, well, in the follow-up study, I will include measures of perceived success and self-efficacy in math because we have seen that math is actually a big problem. And we wanna see if it's not only the ability, right? Is this a problem of they were not taught how to apply the math, or do they feel they're not good enough at math and that is affecting the way they apply it? So this is a question that we need to answer in order to start finding a solution and a change we can do in the classroom. We also found a clear curricular target, which is math, right? There's problems in the way math is being applied in chemistry, and that is connected to past injustices in the K-12 system. And that explains both the reason why Latinx and Black students may be scoring a little bit lower, right? But we also showed that by disaggregating data, so by not putting everybody together and by separating Black and Latinx students, right? We found another systemic issue, right? That shows that the experience of Latinx students and Black students in this campus is different, right? And if we have kept them together in a category of non-white students, we would have never been able to make this connection, right? And that would actually explain why there's an additional hit on Black students' score. So there's the math problem hit, right? And then you have this issue that was happening on campus in that moment, and that would explain why their scores were even lower. Right. And so again, none of these things were actually due to students' abilities or innate things, right? It had to do with systemic problems that were happening either in the past or in the present. I want to acknowledge my co-authors on the QuantCrit paper. So not so much on this study about that I presented the practical implications, but the QuantCrit table that I showed you has been developed with my colleagues, Catherine Husbein, Vanessa Ralph, and Megan Deshay. So that table was developed alongside them. And I also want to acknowledge the support from my PhD advisors, my both and two of my postdocs advisors that had allowed me actually to just do my research and just ask these questions that usually I would not have been able to do without support. And to the CAS Future Leaders Program in Chemistry from the American Chemical Society. And so thank you for listening. And now I'm ready for your questions. So I'm gonna stop sharing.
Thank you so much, Dr. Vincent-Ruz, for your wonderful presentation. Very relevant to many of our efforts around diversity, equity, inclusion. So I'd like to start by asking you how we as instructors can be more equitable in the classroom. I know you mentioned, you know, several topics in your presentation, but I wanted to give you a chance to maybe expand on that a little bit and give us some practical advice.
Yeah, thank you for that question. So I think the first thing is always every time our immediate response is to think, my students are not interested, my students are not prepared, right? Every like that we have this like innate response. I think the first thing we need to do is to pause and say, okay, what could be happening in the system, right, that is not supporting my students? And it could be something in your classroom or it could be something outside your classroom, right? Obviously, you have power to change things in your classroom. And so think about really like, okay, if I'm observing this, if this is where students are struggling, how can I add support to students to do better, right? So instead of like going in like really fast to the like, well, they're not prepared, there's nothing I can do. Think about those sort of things, right? And so I think that is the first thing to do. And the second thing I think that we can do is to really think about the power instructors have in their own departments. So really think about what are the ways that your department is talking about students, the way your department is filtering students. Is your department thinking about certain classes, filtering classes versus actual teaching classes, right? And I think there's collective power in change. So if you actually get together and think, let's stop seeing engineering 101 as a filtering class, let's actually see it as a class to uplift students. What would we change in a curricular way? And that is a tiny thing that can make a huge change in the experience of students in college.
That's great. That's very helpful. Thank you for your answer. You know, we've had a DEI climate survey here at Michigan about 5 years ago when we started our DEI plan, the university-wide plan. So there's a question about how do you recommend institutions improve the DEI climate surveys and how they analyze them? So do you have any thoughts on that? I know you talked about quantitative versus qualitative data and how we can use both types of data. As we, you know, we just had the 5-year DEI climate survey that was university-wide, and we're getting ready to release that data and share it with our community. So any thoughts on that would be helpful.
I am not super familiar about the specific questions because I'm like arrived here in 2020. What I can say is that usually the way institutions collect data is with this, like is the categories we create as an institution have a purpose, right? So we have Black students, Latinx students, Asian students, right? And we don't disagree anymore. And that shows some of the priorities of the university. But institutional data is not meant to give us nuance always, right? And sometimes it means that in DEI surveys, we need to think about whether we have to ask for questions to be more disaggregated instead of using institutional definitions to define people. And that is a tension that always happens when we're doing climate surveys. I don't know the particular case of this one. It's just a general tension that I have observed with climate surveys. And the other thing is that climate surveys can be very useful to say, okay, this is what people are feeling, right? But it always needs to come with actions. So it's not useful to just say 50% of students feel like they're being marginalized, right? If the institution then doesn't come up with like a specific action about how to solve this problem. Right. And so climate surveys are great to tell us what's happening. Right. But if they're not tied to actions and commitments, right, they're just posturing. Right. We're just showing that we care about equity, but we're not willing to do anything to fix it. Right. And so like it's a two-step process. Right. And so as an institution, I think there needs to be a lot of thinking about how the results connect to actions. Right. And that is what I hope to see when these results come out.
Absolutely, absolutely. And what we've done is we followed up with specific focus groups to get more information.
You know, and that is a great way of doing wider, that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. That's very helpful. We're also interested here. We got a question about examples on good concrete articles in higher ed, particularly in STEM. What authors or paper would you recommend? So for folks who would like to dive in a little bit deeper on this topic.
Yeah, this is harder to say in a talk, but I have given the organizers a link. I have a whole section of my website that has resources on concrete. So they will be helpful if you send the link to the attendees so they can look at it. Right. Concrete is very new. I just want people to know this. So we're still figuring things out. Me and everybody in this field, we're still figuring things out about how to even apply these things. But there's some very, very good articles out there. It's just a matter of like, understand that not everything, we have not solved all the kinks yet.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yes. And your website is now linked in the chat for those of you who are interested in diving a little bit deeper and learning a bit more about the research. That's there for you. Yes. So, a question came in about, let's see, future work. If you know of any future work or know of anyone who studies queer students in STEM within this quantcrit space.
Yeah, thank you for this question. Yes, so there's people doing this. I particularly am working on a project regarding this. I am not the lead of it. I'm mentoring a grad student, and this grad student is actually the lead on this project. And so we did this qualitatively, not quantitatively first. So we wanted to understand chemistry students. So when they're applying to grad school, trans and non-binary students' experience when applying to grad school. And like what kinds of signals institution were giving them about the supports they would have or would not have, and whether they will be affirmed in their identities and their existence. And so the reason we chose to do this qualitatively first is because creating a survey or a mathematical measure without really understanding the voices of the people that are involved on this situation is not really good practice. So that's what we're starting from a qualitative point of view. And the student name is Isaac Life. They are in the chemistry department. This is their project. I'm just guiding them through it. And so this is a really cool study that we're working on and that hopefully will then lead to a concrete project that we can look maybe at a bigger sample, right? I will recommend the work by I'm gonna put it in the chat. How do I answer in text? So Z.Nicolazzo. Has done a lot of work about trans and non-binary students, and she has a paper about actually the damage that quantitative methods can do to trans and non-binary students, and this is a real good place to start to think about concrete and queer studies. And then the Journal of Chemical Education had a special issue on diversity, equity, and inclusion, and in that special issue that just came out, there's, I think, two specific studies that use quantitative methods to understand queer students' experiences in science. And as I remember, that even though they didn't use quantcrit explicitly, like they didn't name that explicitly, they actually used really good principles to analyze the data.
That's great, that's great. Thank you for that. So here at U of M, you know, we'd like to improve around diversity, equity, and inclusion. We know we have a long ways to go still. Do you have examples for how faculty and staff can push our institution to make those changes that we've been discussing for so long, you know, around equity?
You know, institutions are slow to change. That is the reality of it, right? And yes. A primarily white institution was never designed to welcome students that were non-white, right? I think the step number one is not wait until things come from the top. And I do think staff and faculty just need to band together to do this. The problem is that sometimes departments don't have the critical mass of people to push for these changes, right? So there may be one or two people in the faculty that want to make these changes, but everybody else doesn't want to do it. And that is when it gets really hard for faculty and staff to push for things, because they don't have collective power to do it or to push for things. And so it's a hard question to answer, because the reality is that U of M has the resources and the power to do it. And if they have not done it, it's because they don't want to. And I know this is my employer and I'm really proud of work here, but this is the reality, right? We have the money, we have the resources to do it. What is missing is the will, not the way. And so I think there has to be a push for bringing in more experts, more faculty that actually understand these issues, but not tokenize them and not burden them with like service, but actually just bring them, because they will be actually able to teach our students to just learn to see the world in a different place, in a different way. It has to do with who is in leadership and who we're promoting into leadership positions, right? And to really think about who is in those positions. Are those people actually representative of the population we want to serve? And it goes back to asking ourselves as an institution, right? Who is our mission to serve, right? And I know when you are a Research One institution that is really prestigious like U of M, we have this tension of that we're supposed to be teaching the smartest kids in the world and like the ones that come already super ready to come to college. And so when you really want to make change, I think maybe it's time to ask yourselves, right? Like, who do we want to serve? Who is our mission to serve as students? And so it's a complicated thing that goes
up. I know, it's a loaded question. Experts such as yourself and lecturers such as the one we just heard are very important towards changing the culture. And here at Michigan Engineering, we are very interested in this culture shift where we're interested in improving diversity, equity, and inclusion in our college and also, you know, beyond. So this brings us to the end of our time together. I want to thank you so much, Dr. Vincent-Ruz, for your presentation and for spending time with us today. Thank you so much. This talk has been recorded and will be available for others who could not make it today. And we will follow up via email with that link.
Yeah, I put the title of the paper and the year. And if you look for it like that, you will find it in Google Scholar.
Great. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
So with that, I'd like to thank you all for joining us today. Our next EI lecture will be on March 24th at noon, featuring Will Sherry, who is the director of the Spectrum Center and interim director of strategic initiatives at Student Life. You will find the registration link in the chat, and I hope to see you at this event. And Mr. Sherry will be sharing some impactful practices that can be taken by units and departments to enhance LGBTQ plus diversity, equity, and inclusion. You will see an invitation forthcoming with more details, so please watch for your email, and we do hope to see you there. Thank you all, and have a great day.